Amen. Let's close our eyes and quiet our hearts and pray in unity. Abba, Father, we approach your throne in the salvation of Christ. By your Spirit, Lord, we count as truly as our privilege to be able to pray to you, Lord. Our being mortal bodies can approach the everlasting throne in the heavenly realm. It's not a human doing. It's truly by the grace of God that we are redeemed. The very fact that we can be here, worship you in spirit and in truth, is a manifestation of your grace and love. And Lord, every single one of us come here, not by our own will, Lord. It is by your divine love we are here. And right now, Lord, when we are here, when we dwell in your presence, we ask you to fill us with your presence, with your spirit, with your joy, with your peace, and with your love. Lord, in this Christmas season, even though the pandemic is still rampant, even though many pains are still real, and Lord, our hearts rejoice at the fact we are redeemed. Today, we are going to reflect on your salvation through Jesus Christ. And Lord, open our eyes to see a glimpse of your divine plan. And Lord, give us hope in this suffering and in this world. And Lord, give us joy in the midst of all kinds of challenges. And Father, we pray on behalf of the congregation. We pray for the students and who are going through the Zoom classes and the other new challenges that come in their way. And Lord, give them the sense of hope. And this suffering is temporary. And I ask you to give them the joy to persevere and to really kind of take advantage of this time that they can be home and that they can have this online experience. And Lord, I also ask you to give courage, encouragement to those who may be suffering from physical disease and emotional turmoil. And Lord, heal us as we continue to worship you in your word. I ask you to anoint your servant Fun as he delivers your message. Give him the power to convict the sinners and give him the power to deliver the message of peace and truth. Thank you, Lord. We lift our prayers, thanksgiving, all in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Jeff. Good morning, sisters and brothers. Again and again, it is an encouragement to be here, to see all of you online today, and ready and willing to receive God's word unto our lives today. Now, as we know, as we said last week, this season is Advent, meaning it is a time we ask God through the Holy Spirit to prepare our hearts prepare our hearts to truly not just mentally reflect upon Jesus' birth, but to feel and experience and reintegrate our lives into the impact, into the implication of Jesus Christ's birth. This is a season of Advent, a season of waiting, of eager expectation and longing. And today we're going to dive into a text. I'm going to continue in the book of Matthew, where Alex Chen left off last week. I'm going to continue in the book of Matthew. And we're going to see this eager anticipation from none other than the earthly father of Jesus Christ himself. If you have your Bibles with you, please turn with me to Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. I will read it one time through for us, and from there I will pray for us to begin. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband, Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as Joseph considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. And all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph awoke from his sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you in your Son, Jesus Christ, and by your Holy Spirit. We just thank you for the time you've given us, Lord. It is December 13th of 2020. It has been many months since the pandemic started in this country. We ask you, please, continue to sustain us. We thank you for your sustenance thus far. Lord, in this moment, we come before you. We ask that you please break down our pride, break down our barriers, lower our masks. We may truly come before you in all humility, come before you in all of who we are, all of our brokenness, all of our stress, our sorrow, our concerns, our success and our failures. We may come before you to know, God, to experience, no doubt about it, God, that in light of all of these things in our lives and in the world and in the church, in light of all of these things, you have spoken. You have provided the only alternative to all of our concerns in our lives. And this began with the birth of your Son. We ask that in this moment, please soften our hearts, open our ears, so we may truly listen to you, God, that we may not just hear empty words, but that we would truly hear your words, God. And in this moment, we surrender our distractions unto you. We are easily led astray, God, just like the sheep, easily distracted. So we come before you now, we ask, Lord, that you please guide our hearts and our minds in this time, that we may truly actively receive your word today and wrestle with it. We trust that at the end of the day, it is you, Holy Spirit, in and through the problems in our lives and in through the misunderstandings of your word, and in through all of these things, Lord. We trust that it is you ultimately, God, through your Holy Spirit, making sense and helping us to understand in your timing and in your ways. It is now we come before you and surrender this time. In your name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. I can imagine, and I can see, that it has been a couple days since Joseph had received news that was very troublesome. You see, it's been a couple days since Joseph had received news that his fiance, Mary, was pregnant. But this pregnancy was not of Joseph's doing at all. But in his day and age, husband and wife will not come together to live together until the husband is finished preparing everything for the wife. And it is at this point that I can see Joseph feeling this anxiety, this stress over his situation. I can imagine Joseph thinking, oh my goodness, what is going to happen now to my life, to Mary's life, now that this situation has happened? I can hear Joseph truly, truly echoing these concerns in his mind, not really knowing what's going on, for Mary has not spoken to Joseph in almost over a year. And yet this is the news that Joseph receives about the status of his fiance. Now, brothers and sisters, we need to understand that the story of Jesus' birth is a story. It is not an isolated event. It did not occur out of nowhere, out of randomness. But Jesus' birth was set in a very specific context, a very specific point in human history and culture. And it is here that we dive into that in Joseph's life. And as Joseph continues to try to process this news that his fiance Mary is now pregnant from who knows whom, I can imagine Joseph trying to think of all of the scenarios of what's he going to do about this situation. This is a very scandalous situation, contrary to our day and age here in the States. Pregnancy outside of marriage in Joseph and Mary's culture was a deep, deep crime, legally speaking and culturally speaking. So I can only imagine what Joseph, what he must have been feeling. The scandal of it all, especially in his day and age. Joseph was a righteous person, a righteous man, meaning that Joseph would always do the action, speak the words that have the health of the community in mind, along with his own reputation. And it is in this context that this scandal of a engagement, this pregnancy outside of marriage, has landed at Joseph's doorstep. It's not just Joseph's reputation on the line, you see, but it's also his relationship with this community around him. I can only imagine Joseph feeling like, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? If word gets out, our whole village is going to gossip. Our whole village is going to slander, not just myself, but especially Mary. And it is in this context that Joseph reaches two conclusions about what he's going to do. There is really only two ways of what Joseph can do, especially to stay true to his righteous character. This scandal pregnancy. First option that Joseph would have had is make it public. Making this situation a public situation was very acceptable in this culture. Joseph could have called Mary out. He could have went to Mary's house, knocked on her door, gathered the whole village in Mary's doorstep, and basically just exposed her, basically just accused her of what she has done. She has been impregnated outside of marriage, and especially not from her fiancé, Joseph. Joseph could have easily, and in this culture, legally speaking, and even righteously speaking, Joseph could have done this. Could have easily called out Mary. And perhaps some may argue that this was maybe the more righteous choice, to call out Mary, to call her out for her sin. And yet, what is recorded here in Scripture? Joseph says this in verse 19, and her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her, Mary, to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. You see, we see from here that Joseph didn't want to publicly shame Mary in front of the whole community, which possibly would lead to Mary's isolation from the community and not being provided for in this society. Instead, Joseph wants to divorce her quietly, in secrecy, in private. That it was perhaps because Joseph truly did love Mary. He truly cared for Mary. That he wouldn't wish this burden, this shame upon Mary and her family. So instead, he would divorce her quietly, in secret, and behind the scenes. That perhaps, I can imagine Joseph thinking, that this would be less of a scandal. This would be less of a scandal to divorce her quietly. We see as Joseph considers these things, as he wrestles with this situation, not knowing too much about it other than Mary's pregnant. That very same night, in the middle of the chaos, in the middle of the turmoil in Joseph's heart, that very same night, one of God's messengers, an angel, appears to Joseph and says this in verse 20. But as he, Joseph, considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. Now, to be clear, ladies and gentlemen, the God is outside of our human biological function. The God could do many miracles, one miracle being pregnancy. To a woman that is a virgin, meaning has never slept with a man, that God can do such miracles for his own greater purposes. And yet we see here that the angel reassures Joseph. As troubled as Joseph was awaiting the birth of this child, as stressed as Joseph was awaiting the birth of this child, this angel, the messenger of God, comes to Joseph and tries to reassure him that this is all in God's plan. And notice this little bit, tidbit of detail here. The angel says to Joseph, son of David. Son of David. If you remember last week, Alex preached a bit on Jesus' lineage, his genealogy, his family history. But we see here that, ladies and gentlemen, it has been over 400 years since any word has come from God. After all of these generations, as Alex preached last week, through all of them, it has been over 400 years since God has spoken to any single human being at this time. And it is here, when Joseph sees the angel, this is the first time in 400 years that God speaks to humanity yet again. And what is the first thing that God says in over 400 years to humans? He says, Joseph, son of David. Son of David. You see, the angel doesn't just say, hey, Joseph, you know, just in your average Joe living in the countryside. Hey, Joseph, average Joe. This is me, an angel from God. No, the angel says, Joseph, son of David. And if you remember correctly last week, this title, son of David, carries so much weight, so much significance. Because it is essentially God saying, after 400 years of silence, I am keeping true to my promise to David, to his children. So Joseph, son of David. And during this time, Joseph, he was nobody. Joseph was just basically just a country boy living in the middle of nowhere, in a middle of nowhere town, in the middle of nowhere country. Joseph was nobody in this culture, in this society. Joseph didn't even matter to this society. And yet we see here that the angel of God comes to Joseph and he says, Joseph, Joseph, son of David, you are a somebody. Because of who God is. Joseph, in this society, you have no higher rank. You have no status. You have no influence. And yet God, through the angel, says, Joseph, son of David, the very descendant of King David, the very king who was after God's heart. The angel reassures Joseph, Joseph, son of David, God remembers his promise unto King David, and now through you. The first thing God says in 400 years is that he remembers his promise to King David that is now being fulfilled in Joseph. So we see here that as Joseph awaits this child from Mary, the first thing that we see here is his waiting period. The angel reassures him. God's promise. As you're waiting for this child to be born, you need to remember God's promise. Again, as you're waiting for this child to be born, you need to remember God's promise leading up to the birth of the child. But the angel doesn't stop there. What else does the angel say to Joseph? The very same Joseph who is right now caught in a hurricane of scandal, a hurricane of stress and anxiety, because he is going to be penalized because his fiance is pregnant and the baby's not from him. And in this culture, that is a huge deal. There is going to be a lot of consequences in that situation. And even as stressed as Joseph is, angel reassures him, hey, God's plan, God's promise. What else does the angel say to Joseph? He says this, verse 21, she will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Now, just a little quick, brief, biblical Hebrew lesson here. Jesus' name, the root letters and meaning of Jesus' name means to save, or it means Savior. That is the meaning of Jesus' name. That is why we call him Jesus. And specifically in Hebrew, Yeshua means to save, or Savior, or salvation. And that's Jesus' very name. It's the very DNA of who Jesus is. The Savior. So much so that they literally call him the Savior. Can you imagine today if someone's name was Master? Like, that's your legal name, Master, right? Like, hey, my legal name is Master. Can you imagine that? That to us, that sounds kind of awkward. But in Jesus' day, that was what they did. They named people literally about these titles. They literally named them those titles. Jesus' name is literally Savior. It's like I see Jesus and I say, Savior, Savior, Savior Christ, right? That's the Savior. That's Jesus' literal name, Savior. That's a heavy title. But Savior from what? Savior from what? Ladies and gentlemen, if you really think about it, many times we can be like Joseph in this situation. We're so bombarded. We're just so entrenched, so dragged down with this world's concerns, with our loneliness, with our stress, with our expectations. We're just so dragged down by so many times of the cares of the world. And that many times when we anticipate the birth, we really don't have a sense of peace or joy or hope. We don't have a sense of anticipation because we're so stressed and worried about our responsibilities in this world. It's similar to Joseph. In this moment, that's exactly what he was feeling. He was feeling, you know, this stress and this, oh man, what am I going to do about this situation? This is not a good situation for Joseph and Mary, for her to be pregnant and they're engaged, but the baby's not his. Very dangerous situation. I can just imagine Joseph being stressed about that. Even as he's counting down the days to the birth, he's still stressed about that. And ladies and gentlemen, we might not be stressed about the very exact same situation as Joseph, but in our day-to-day lives, just this month so far, have we also been distracted, occupied with other things in our hearts and our minds, so much so that we actually miss the point of Jesus' birth? We actually miss the anticipation of Jesus' birth. But we see here that Jesus' birth, ladies and gentlemen, is for one purpose: to save his people from their sins. I don't know about you, but many times when I think of Jesus' birth, I don't really think about that. You know, a lot of times I think about other things. I'm like, oh man, yeah, Jesus is born. My life is going to be better. I'm going to be happy. Everything is going to be more comfortable. You know, like I will have some direction in my life. Jesus, if you can just help me do that. Yeah, be born into the world, Jesus, and help me do that in my life. The scripture says, hey, Jesus is not born to help you with your life. Jesus is not born to make your life more comfortable. Jesus is not born to solve your problems. Jesus is born to save you from sin, to save you from the very thing, the very essence that is the root of all of your problems, that is the very foundation of all of your problems. Jesus is born to fight that. Jesus is born to abolish that, to eradicate, to decimate that sin. Jesus is born for that purpose. Ladies and gentlemen, as we are waiting, unlike Joseph, ladies and gentlemen, let us know that Jesus' birth happens to uproot all of our problems, our situations, to uproot the core issues here of our lives. That the core problem of our lives today is not loneliness, it's not coronavirus, it's not poverty, it's not any of these things. The core problem of our lives is sin. And if that doesn't strike a chord with you, and if that doesn't bring you on your face before God in surrenderance, that in itself is revealing about what we really believe about God and Christ. What we really understand about sin. And I pray that every single year, as we go through Advent, as we go through Christmas, that God will show all of us more and more and more the weight and the significance of Jesus' birth to fight the very sin. You see, ladies and gentlemen, like Joseph? When we hear about sin, are we like Joseph? When Joseph would have heard about the child that's going to be born from Mary is going to save him from sin, Joseph would have been like, my mind is blown. Sin? Angel of the Lord, you are telling me that this child that Mary's going to have is going to save people from sin. The very same infection that existed in Genesis 3, sin, going back to the beginning of human existence, sin, that very same thing. You're telling me this child, born out of cultural norms, born out of the normal functioning of our Jewish society, this child is going to defeat sin. That's unthinkable. If the angel would have said, hey, Joseph, this child, he's gonna make you a lot of money. Hey, Joseph, this child, he's gonna heal some people. Hey, Joseph, this child, he's gonna cast out some demons. Joseph would have been, oh, that's pretty cool. Yeah, that's pretty neat. You know, that's gonna make him pretty unique. Yeah, people are gonna notice he's gonna be pretty cool around in their society. The angel didn't say that, though. Angel says, Joseph, Jesus is going to save people from their sin. Their sin, ladies and gentlemen. As we are waiting for Advent, as we are anticipating Jesus' birth, are we keeping that reality on the forefront of our minds that every single year when we think about Jesus' birth, do we think about how Jesus has liberated us from sin, from the chains, from the bindings of the darkness, from the bindings of the wickedness of our own hearts and the wickedness of other people's hearts? Do we actually care about that? Because that's why Jesus was born. Jesus is not born to make our lives better, more comfortable. Jesus is born to transform all of that. But that begins defeating sin. And that, ladies and gentlemen, during this Advent season, this Christmas season, really ask yourself that question. As Scripture says, knowing that Jesus is born to save us from sin, does that cause a joy in you? Or are we just indifferent? Are we just like, that's pretty cool, but it would have been better if Jesus, did this for me or did that for me rather than save me from my sin, because sin is like, I don't even know what that is anyway. So Jesus, why don't you just help me with something else? Something more practical. Something that helped me be more productive or have a more efficient life. You see, if we don't even flinch at this verse that Jesus saves us from our sin, ladies and gentlemen, then this whole Advent season is pointless. This whole Advent season is meaningless. Apart from Jesus defeating sin, why are we even here? Why are we even on Zoom? That's the whole point of Christ's birth, to defeat sin. And during this time, Advent season is usually, called about like, during the season, we should have hope, we should have joy, we should have peace. And those are all good things. However, to say that we have hope, now that we have hope through Christ, right? To say that is also to assume before Christ, there was no hope. To say that we have peace because of Jesus' birth is to say before Christ, there was no peace. To say, that there is joy because of Christ's birth is to say there was no joy before Christ. But why? Why does joy, hope, and peace exist? Why are these three topics the most common during Christmas season? Because Jesus came to save us from sin. That's why. It's because Jesus saves us from sin, we have hope. It's because Jesus saves us from sin, we have peace. It is because Jesus saves us from sin that we have joy. Apart from that, those things are meaningless. We need to see the bigger picture here, ladies and gentlemen. That God is so much bigger than just your life and my life and your personal problems and my personal problems. God is so much bigger than that. That Jesus came to do something way bigger than just feed the hungry or heal the sick. Because in case you didn't know this, healing, casting out demons existed even before Jesus was born. That's not new. That's not unique to Christ. But the unique thing that Jesus does is saying that he came to defeat sin, to save the people from sin. That's something that no one else has ever done in human history. That is exactly, during this Christmas season, that is exactly what we are looking forward to. Not just to mentally remember, but to do a whole 180 on our 180 degrees on our life. I don't know about you, but throughout this whole 2020, this year 2020, I felt so many times in my life, I'm just swerving everywhere. I'm going left and right, taking a bunch of detours away from God. And it is exactly in this month of December, during Advent, that God is going to bring us back unto himself. He's going to bring us back from the detours. He's going to bring us back from being lost. To be fixed upon his path, fixed upon his kingdom, his work, that has always belonged to his children. But many times we lose sight of that in the busyness of life and in other stresses and concerns of life. That is exactly during this time that we need to remember Jesus' birth exists to save us from our sin. And this should not be new news at all. You see, during this time when Joseph would have heard this news, Joseph would have freaked out as well. Joseph would have been, what? Hold up, angel of the Lord, hold up. You're telling me that Jesus, the promised Messiah of over thousands of years, okay? The promised Messiah is going to save us from sin. But what about our oppression? What about the Roman oppression? You know, the Romans have been oppressing us for a long time. What about saving us from all of this ethnic and cultural conflict with all these other people groups in Israel? What about that, angel of the Lord? Why don't Jesus save us from that? Isn't that more practical? Isn't that more efficient? Isn't that more productive? Why wouldn't Jesus save us from that? Why would Jesus only save us from sin, but not really from the Romans and not really from ethnic tensions? And many times we could be thinking of Joseph in this manner. And even as you read the Gospels, many people were also surprised that Jesus didn't come, the Messiah didn't come to fix all their political problems and their social problems. Instead, he came to fix something bigger than that, something deeper than that. Now, that doesn't mean social and political problems are meaningless. Of course not. But they have their place. But do we know the place of sin? That's the question. Have we placed our politics and our social concerns above sin? As if God should solve those issues first and then deal with sin later. But actuality, scripture says, no, actually, social political problems are below sin. Sin comes first. It needs to be dealt with. And then everything else will follow. You see, ladies and gentlemen, this is what it means for Jesus to be born on this earth, that he himself was born on this earth because of sin, to fight and defeat the sin. We must, as believers especially, we must not lose this truth in the midst of our busyness, in the midst of our stress. We must not lose this truth, because the moment we do, we don't know the significance, the purpose of what it means to truly follow Christ. Now, lastly, the angel says this to Joseph. Verse 22. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. Emmanuel, it's Hebrew, which means God with us. Now, even this would have been so, again, mind-blowing to Joseph as well. Because you must remember, during this time, God's presence, God's very being was restricted to the temple, a building. That's where people met God. That's where people would go to feel God, at a temple, at a building. But here, the angel of the Lord, after 400 years of silence, the angel of the Lord comes to Joseph and says, Joseph, God is going to be with you. God is going to walk with you. God is going to eat with you. God is going to drink with you. God is going to cry in your arms as a baby. The presence of God is with you now. No longer is the presence of God in a building. No longer is the presence of God restricted to one location. Now the presence of God is walking, is talking, is breathing, is eating, is sleeping. The presence of God is in this, is this child, Jesus. And Joseph would have, his mind would have been melted. He would have been so, couldn't even fathom what the angel was saying. This was so contradictory to their cultural norms at this time. Now, ladies and gentlemen, similarly, as we wait to remember the day Jesus is born, as we anticipate that, do we also feel this, like Joseph, do we feel this sense of like, basically mind blown, basically unfathomableness? Do we feel that? Do we experience that in Jesus' birth? Or are we just like, oh, yeah, it's just another year. It's just another December. It's just another Christmas. Nothing different. Everything's the same. Everything's fine. Just another whatever. Like, it doesn't really matter to us. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not trying to force this upon you, but we do need to seriously reevaluate ourselves and our perceptions on Jesus' birth. Because right now we are waiting. Are we waiting like Joseph? Or are we waiting on our own terms? Are we waiting for Jesus' birth like Joseph, thinking, wow, like, this is pretty like beyond human logic? How can a virgin have a baby through the Holy Spirit, and that baby is going to save humanity and their sin? And that baby is God himself, his very presence with us. That in itself, like, doesn't even make sense. Logically speaking, humanly speaking, it doesn't make sense. But that's the point. Because if it did humanly, logically make sense, and that's just it. It's just human. It's just logic. Restricted to only those categories. But ladies and gentlemen, we see here that as Joseph waits for the birth of Jesus, the truth of Jesus is finally revealed. God's promise is being kept to King David. Jesus will save people from their sin. And God will from now finally dwell with his people, living and breathing with them, walking with them. Ladies and gentlemen, as we wait to remember Jesus' birth this year, do we also think about these three things, or do we think about something else? When we think about Jesus' birth, when we anticipate Jesus' birth, are we looking forward to remembering and experiencing these truths, that God keeps his promises, that God, through Christ, saved us, through Jesus, from our sin. And lastly, that God is with us through Christ. Are these three basic truths of Jesus' birth depicted in this passage, are we looking forward to these three basic truths every single year? To truly ask God to change and move our hearts towards this direction, towards this path of God's truth. Those three simple things changes all of reality, changes all of philosophy, it changes all of human existence. God keeps his promises. Jesus saves us from our sins. And God is with us in the flesh. And now through his Holy Spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, as we continue in this Advent season, ask yourself these questions. Because if we're honest, many times we don't really think about this stuff. And we're just looking forward to other things like vacation or something, something simple. But do we actually know the fullness of our faith? Do we actually believe the truth of who Christ is and his birth, the significance of his birth? And if you just don't feel that weight, if you just don't feel the significance, if you just don't understand it, that's okay. That's okay. Well, you need to start somewhere. You need to begin now. You need to begin here and now. Ask God to show you, to break you, to break your heart, break your pride. You may truly accept it and understand and experience it amongst yourself. And for all of us to know that we're not alone in that. If you look on this screen, a bunch of names, you know, a couple faces, you see that we're not alone in that journey, in that endeavor, because we're supposed to do that together. That's the whole point of the church, to do that together. Now, from here on out, as we continue throughout the month of December, please take some time to meditate upon these simple verses that I just read to you in Matthew 1, verse 18 to 25. Take time to read that again today, that you may know for sure the significance of Jesus' birth is way beyond us. It's about God's promises. It's about Jesus saving us from sin, the root of all evil and suffering. And it's about Jesus' birth showing that God is with us, physically with us. Not just emotionally or mentally with you, but physically with you as well. Can you imagine that? Well, you don't need to imagine it. It already is. It already exists. But again, if this doesn't strike you, surrender unto God. Ask him to show you that you may truly experience and feel this weight. We may feel that together as a church. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you and we surrender this Advent season to you. God, if we're honest, many times we really don't. We really don't feel the magnitude, the weight. We really don't feel the significance of your birth, Jesus. We really don't. We really don't understand that your birth, Jesus, was such an unthinkable, such a scandalous situation. And Mary and Joseph obeyed and willingly endured the slander, the gossip from the community, that you, Jesus, will be born into this world. Apart from human wisdom and human effort, you, Jesus, will be born. But we ask you, please lead us today through your Holy Spirit to truly deeply reflect, open our hearts, that as we wait and to remember your birth, Jesus, do we actually care that you, God, keep your promises? Do we actually care that you, God, through Christ, save us from our sin? Do we actually care that you, God, are with us physically, mentally, emotionally, of course, spiritually, all regards, you're with us. Do we care about these things? Because that is exactly the significance of your birth, Jesus. So in light of this, Lord, we ask you, please continue to humble us. Please continue to help us to understand all of this. No matter where we are right now in life, no matter what we're stressed with, no matter what we're concerned with right now in life, we ask you, please, continue to show us. Show us, Lord, that you're with us during these struggles and that you have already taken all of these struggles, the root of the struggles, sin. You've taken all of that and you've defeated it. May you please lead us to live in your triumph and at the same time also witness in and through our struggles. Teach us through our struggles as well, God. Especially during these pandemic days. Lord, it is in all of these things that we surrender unto you. We ask and we trust you, please continue to put a yearning, a hunger on our hearts for you, God, a hunger that is unquenchable, that this world can never, ever satisfy. Please place that hunger upon us through the Holy Spirit, that we may genuinely seek you, to know you, to be with you, to love and serve you and, by extension, the church, your body of Christ. It is in light of this truth we trust you will continue to heighten our longing and anticipation of remembrance of your birth, but also the implications of your birth. Thank you so much. We surrender all this unto you. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.